to Richmond, where VCU students have been calling Shakaville home, wanted to be part of the most anticipated game of the season, a rematch against A-10 leading St. Louis, which is looking to start a new win streak. Bracket Builder Week continues, and tonight, for the second time in 2 weeks, VCU getting set to battle number 10 St. Louis, and the Atlantic 10 standings, they continue to draw ever closer. St. Louis now trying to stay ahead of St. Joe's, got another win today. UMass lost, so VCU for the moment up to third in the Atlantic 10 standings. Welcome to Richmond with Fran Fraschilla. I'm Mark Kestershue. We've got two very experienced teams getting set to go head-to-head again, but they do it very differently.
Well, they do it with defense, and that's bred two winning cultures. VCU, havoc, full court pressure. St. Louis, pack it in, make teams shoot over the top, aggressive play in the paint.
Well, as we get to Fran's one-on-one, it is that havoc defense, and now St. Louis will break that pressure tonight.
Well, when you talk about havoc, the face of it is Briante Weber, who leads the country in steals, and that leads to easy offense for the Rams. On the other hand, in that first meeting, once the Billikens figured out havoc, they were able to score in transition, led by Jordaire Jett, their brilliant point guard.
Take a look at our starting lineups. Jordaire Jett leading the visiting number 10 St. Louis Billikens. Their top scorer and rebounder is Dwayne Evans, another senior. Doesn't get much more experience than that. All seniors for St. Louis. For VCU, number 21, Treveon Graham. Their top scorer only had 4 points in the win against Fordham the other night. And look at number 32, Melvin Johnson, a sophomore. He's going to get his second straight start. As they say, when he's in the lineup, they are playing at a more offensive pace uptick. And of course, when we all woke up this morning, Fran, it was March. We've got a March feel inside this building, and something's got to give, because VCU hasn't lost at home, and there's not too many teams that can say they haven't lost on the road, like two of them.
Exactly, and remember, VCU has lost the last 3 times to St. Louis in Atlantic 10 play, but this is the first meeting between the two teams here at VCU.
Got a look at a Shaka Smart there, as this crowd, all clad in gold, about to rise to its feet. 2 weeks ago, St. Louis got the better of VCU in St. Louis, and the other night, a real stunner for the Billikens, who had won a school record 19 straight games, losing to Duquesne, and that great three-point defense failed them on Thursday night.
And it speaks to the depth of this league. Duquesne at the bottom, but has played very competitively.
VCU wins the tip. Our officials, Paul Fea, Eric Anderson, Tony Crisp, and VCU, which hasn't lost in this building since late January of last year, will get its first look. Weber, ultra quick guard, has the first points for the Rams.
He went right at Evans on the mismatch. They created the mismatch. Weber took advantage of it. Here comes havoc.
Now remember, they saw havoc 2 weeks ago, and Weber right in front of us got a hand on it. Briante Weber, the nation's leader in steals.
We'll teach you all night about this stuff. Man-to-man full, and when they feel they can come and jump and trap, they'll spring it on you.
It's one thing to face havoc in St. Louis, but facing it with almost 8,000 fans on their feet and loud as well. Mike McCall Jr. Talking to Jordaire Jett earlier today, as Jett drives and through some contact against Reddick scores. Talked to him earlier today. Who's the leader with 5 seniors? And he said there really is no leader. It's a lot of sharing going on.
Exactly.
Up for the Billikens.
Winning his senior class in the history of St. Louis.
Reddick knocks down the outside J.
Now watch. Reddick will be on the ball. This looks like their diamond. This is their zone press. They'll mix man and zone pressure.
Well broken by the Billikens. Here's Jett with the dive cut. Score it! That is brilliant break of havoc all the way to the rim.
And that's the concern Shaka Smart had today. He's very hard to trap or keep out of the lane. Low center of balance, quick and strong.
Jordaire Jett, 6'1 senior, listed at 215 pounds out of St. Paul, Minnesota. Reddick passing out. Here's Melvin Johnson. I told him he doesn't look fast as Shaka Smart. He said it's kind of like Barry Sanders. Didn't look fast till he was getting by you. As McCall keeps it alive. And off the turnover. Treveon Graham. They call him Freight Train. They just found it out there.
Bo thought he could save it, but Graham shot the passing lane. Remember, St. Louis struggled with this in the first half of the initial meeting. 12 turnovers.
And getting a hand on it and a near steal. And now St. Louis with numbers, but Lowe can't come up with the bounce pass. Turnover, St. Louis.
Get an idea, even when you break the initial trap, you still must convert at the other end. There's the pass out, the deflection. Now watch the drop pass by Rob Lowe.
Two consecutive turnovers for St. Louis, consecutive possessions. Turnovers was one of the issues, a mild issue in the loss against Duquesne in St. Louis on Thursday night.
Both of these teams, Mark, run a lot of screen and roll.
When we get a look at St. Louis on the defensive end, that's what Shaka Smart said. He was worried about how defensively they blow up that screen and roll so well.
But they have some antidotes today. We'll see them.
Here's Weber tossing another one in. Briante Weber. Shaka Smart called him the most energetic player he's ever met. And a turnover, and it goes right to Weber, who has the school record for steals in a season. Three-pointer. Oh, they would have blown the lid off the place had that one gone in.
Yeah, this is Jim Cruz's worst nightmare right now, yet they're only down 4 points. Mike Rhodes right there, assistant coach. He was one of the architects of havoc, or Shaka Smart. You see, it fist is man-to-man full, double fist is the trap, and then Diamond is the man, is the zone press.
Jaquan Lewis, number one in white, is on the floor. Briante Weber headed to the bench. Check in with the coaches sitting out this possession as Jet breaks the pressure. Jump pass. Barnett's a spot-up shooter and knocks down that triple.
That's what he does. Fifth-year senior Barnett.
Way down court and too far in front of Javonte Redick, a VCU turnover. Redick, senior for VCU, as they set up, and even though they don't score here, a chance to set up this havoc again out of bounds. St. Louis breaking it quickly. And Shaka Smart said they will take the chance. You're on the borderline of gamble there. They will take those chances.
Well, they want to speed the game up. Even if you score, if they make you play fast, it's a moral victory.
Off the Evans miss, Treveon Graham will line up a three. Out of bounds to St. Louis. You can feel it here. All the crowd, and Jim Cruz certainly knows his team really trying to settle them down.
Exactly.
With a very passionate crowd. As both coaches go to substitutions.
Now what you have right now for St. Louis is McBroom in the game. Transfer, good ball handler, two guards now. 2 point guards, I should say. You see Jim Cruz also going to the bench early. It's not a deep bench, Mark, but they're going to need the bench today because of the fatigue factor.
As you mentioned, Austin McBroom on the floor, number two in blue. Also John Manning replacing Rob Lowe, number 54 in blue. 4 minutes gone by, VCU a 1 point lead. Much more patient offensive approach this time. Jet lost the handle, and they'll say it is VCU ball. Four turnovers here in the first half for St. Louis.
Take a look. This is the kind of tempo Shaka Smart trying to create. Ball pressure, harassment. Maybe a save? Nope, a steal. By the way. By one. Coaches, set your DVRs. Here's a little double fist. They come and double the ball, leads to the easy basket. Now watch what we've got here. As the ball starts to come in the man-to-man full, Weber leaves. They've got the trap, three interceptors, shoot the gap, and another steal. Just the pace that Shaka Smart wants to create.
VCU with the 1 point lead over St. Louis, and havoc's already had its effect on the Billikens. Look at that, four turnovers in the first 5 minutes. VCU only created eight in the opening nine 2 weeks ago.
And I would expect the Billikens to adjust quickly to this, make sure they keep the floor spread, move the ball, but also you have Jet who can bust up those traps and get it through the traps and get it up the court.
And VCU will bring it up. Jared Guest on the floor, number 23 in white, setting that initial screen. Briante Weber continues to play on the bench as Jaquan Lewis is in at the point for VCU. Turns around and looks at Coach Shaka Smart.
I like this freshman Lewis, young man outside of Nashville, Tennessee. Made a nice impact early in his career.
Jordan Burgess also getting his first run and our first foul of the game. And against Mike Crawford, also into the game for the first time, a freshman out of Tipton, Indiana. Great score in Indiana.
Absolutely. There you see Shaka Smart, Mark. Played at Kenyon College in Ohio. Been working with guys like Keith Dambrot at Akron, Billy Donovan at Florida, Oliver Purnell at Clemson.
First head coaching job here and took VCU to the Final Four back in 2011. Many had speculated he wasn't long for Richmond, but he has built quite a program here in downtown Richmond. Weber on the floor now.
See how they spread the floor for the dribble drive.
And Brandenburg scores as St. Louis really was packing it inside.
Well, when you go to this dribble drive offense and you spread the floor, it's harder to guard 50 feet. And you saw the gap right there, the ability to break it.
They break the full court pressure. McBroom at its strip, but right into the waiting hands of Grandy Glaze.
Glaze, a good role player, originally signed at UNLV. Now, St. Louis, Mark, they want to pack it in, but watch how VCU spreads them out, looks for the opportunity to get to the rim, and well done that time.
Well, McBroom, that was his first, second foul in the half against St. Louis. This pace has considerably slowed, which would be advantage for St. Louis. Treveon Graham knocks down a triple.
Good job by Brandenburg using that dribble drive.
It is amazing with which the energy that VCU has to expend in a 40-minute game playing Havoc. These guys are in tremendous shape.
Started in the fall with Navy SEAL training. Everything about this program is overload. Make the practices tougher than the games.
Jet calling for a screen from the big man. Off the switch. Pull-up jumper goes down for Jordair Jet. They'll rule that a deep two.
Jordair Jet and his veteran team not going to be intimidated, even though so far the pace has been a good one for the Rams.
Jets hit his first three shots. He's got 6 points. The Atlantic 10's player of the week last week. Third time he's picked up that honor in the last 4 weeks.
And obviously one of the candidates for Atlantic 10 player of the year.
And this is turning more and more into a big game for Jim Cruz and the Billikens as Graham scores again. All the teams below him except for UMass have picked up wins today. So a little bit of pressure, even though the magic number, if you will, is one for St. Louis to clinch at least a share of the conference crown. Here's the big man Lowe getting across the timeline. St. Louis had a school record 28 wins a year ago, already 25-3 this year. Conference tournament less than 2 weeks away. Lowe nearly had a pick by Graham. And Glaze with a nice job underneath.
Mentioned he's a terrific role player, undersized power forward. Signed with Lon Kruger at UNLV, and that staff left for Oklahoma. He opened up the recruitment.
Offensive rebound, Allie Cox puts it in just into the game. Mo Allie Cox, a redshirt freshman, has given VCU the 4-point edge.
He's going to have a great career. You talk about another one of those players Taylor made for Havoc. Only 6'6", 7'1 wingspan.
250-pounder from Middleburg, Virginia. Both teams waiting to send in changes. Three for each team awaiting at the scorer's table. Crawford, ball fake. Allie Cox took the ball. And a loose ball foul underneath is going to go against Rob Lowe, and that'll be his first for St. Louis.
It's all about energy, Mark. Both ends of the floor. Offensive rebounding.
VCU looking to win for the first time against St. Louis in the last 2 years. Look at the past meetings between these teams. You go back to 2010, that's a best of three series that VCU won in two games. And then last year, St. Louis winning in St. Louis in Brooklyn. St. Louis won the A-10 championship game. And then 2 weeks ago, the Billikens won again. So they have dominated the season series over the last three. And Jim Crew's team suffering its first conference loss of the year just the other day.
But look at that 53-10 record. What a great job Jimmy Crews has done. He was pretty much in retirement, doing a little bit of television for the Big Ten Network, coached out of it as an assistant coach to Rick Majerus. And then when Rick Majerus became ill, heart problems last summer, a couple summers ago, Jimmy Crews took over on the interim basis. You know my favorite line, when someone asked him about being the interim coach, he said, "We're all interim. You're interim, I'm interim. We're all interim.
We're all day-to-day, we're all interim. It all fits together." He did a great job last year under very difficult circumstances. The passing of Coach Majerus was the Atlantic 10 Coach of the Year as Burgess misses out of the corner, and he may make it back-to-back conference Coach of the Year titles after doing a fabulous job with St. Louis. McBroom gets fouled. He'll get himself to the free throw line.
Now, I would expect St. Louis to calm down a little bit now and start to get back to what they do well: defend, patient on offense, attack when available. This young man, the transfer from Central Michigan, Austin McBroom, terrific off the bench. You know, he played high school basketball with Drew Holiday at Campbell Hall in Los Angeles. A big difference from Los Angeles to Mount Pleasant, Michigan.
I saw Tony Crisp, the official, kind of wave over to the St. Louis bench, telling the assistants to sit down. I've already had some coaches get into it today across the country. Decorum's been a big buzzword throughout college basketball on this Saturday as McBroom knocks down the free throws.
These two coaches are great competitors. Jimmy Crews, an outstanding role player for Coach Knight, four Big Ten titles.
And putting it off the glass and in is Melvin Johnson. He's from the Bronx, and so when he got the start Thursday night at Fordham, you figured, well, it's because he's home. But here he is, back-to-back starts and coming up with a bucket there. And the quicks of McBroom to trace that one down. You know, we got to look at Jim Crews, and he always looks so stoic and stable, and we were told, here comes a steal off of VCU. Johnson against McCall, up and under. Guest couldn't put it back. Another chance, and Guest will have a chance at a three-point play.
Now this is VCU basketball. Watch the drive, the steal, the turnovers, and then the second chances. This is not a great half-court offensive team, Mark. So what they've got to do is score off of energy. Turnovers, second shots.
And that was the look I was looking at. Very stoic, but we were told by some of the St. Louis people, he's as fiery as anybody in college basketball, and you're getting a look right there. Obviously coming off a loss, and now arms crossed with his team down six, down seven in the first half.
Well, he's always been a winner. The last 2 years in Indiana, they went 63-1.
There's a double waiting at half court. McCall had it tipped away by Lewis. And Jett takes it right back. And St. Louis has numbers. McCall steps behind the three-point line.
I'll tell you, what a great play by Mike McCall Jr. Once Jett had the ball, he relocated to the three-point line. Wasn't going to get a layup out of it. He got three.
Here's Johnson, missing badly that time, but a great save on the end line by Guest. Treveon Graham missing. Last touch by VCU. Now the fans on the baseline, and now it's going to go to the Rams. Tony Crisp realizing after he made the call and made the correction himself.
Let's take a look right here. You see the ball knocked loose by Jordair Jett. Good piece of officiating. Paul Feya came in. And I think Tony Crisp just got a little bit confused.
Here's Guest off the inbound. Guest keeps it alive. That time knocks it out.
I don't think we've seen St. Louis in more than one half-court set so far because they've had to attack this full-court pressure.
There you go. St. Louis, six turnovers to their seven made field goals. They're only down four. Had a big steal last time down in the three-pointer by McCall. There's a lob toward the rim through the hands of Lowe, and another turnover. Turnovers mounting for the Billikens in the first half. Number seven. Now VCU will reset. You know, on defense, they play those passing lanes on the wings aggressively.
Yes, they do. And St. Louis, on the other hand, they play in the paint and force you to turn it over off the dribble.
Weber with the spin move. Mike McCall Jr. cutting to the middle. Jordair Jett says, let's try for something more underneath. Evans.
All right, Evans had a layup, but he dropped that pass from Jett.
Trying to load up inside. Lowe knocked it away. Three games left in the regular season for St. Louis. They only need to win one of the three to clinch at least a share of the conference crown. And VCU right now sitting in pretty good position at number three. Trying to hold serve at home. Shot clock's down to five. Guest with his fourth offensive rebound.
Oh, they're going to count that. That's a mental mistake by the senior Lowe.
Well, the foul, the goaltend, the 2 points, and the free throw coming.
Watch Jared Guest and his activity on the offensive glass. I'm not sure this ball is going in, but it's irrelevant anyway because Lowe interfered with it. Did they count it?
I saw the official come over and drop the two fingers. It's on the scoreboard here in the arena with 24 for VCU. As they allow the substitutions to come in.
You know, it sounds crazy, Mark. This feels like VCU is up 16 instead of 6. And that bodes well for St. Louis.
Yes, missing, but another offensive rebound, and Graham sticks it in.
One thing I've noticed this year around the country, teams are not very good at practicing the block out.
And Havoc, Grant turns it over again. Redick all the way to the basket, and they'll call the block on Lowe, who's going to pick up the foul on the aggressive move from Redick.
Right now, this is all energy by VCU. Not pretty. The execution in the half court, so-so. But the energy level of their defense and their activity on the offensive glass, superb.
Here's Javonte Redick, who had a big game at Fordham. 22 points, 12 rebounds, knocks home the first free throw. He's got 11 double-doubles this year as St. Louis makes wholesale changes.
This is a young man that was recruited by a number of power conference schools. And he decided to, if you say it, it probably doesn't sound right, go down a level.
Okay.
And what he's done over 4 years is continue to improve every single year. And now VCU, obviously, can play with anybody.
6'9", listed at 250. That's about 40 pounds heavier than when he was a freshman. And gets a big hand as Redick heads to the bench.
Here comes that pressure again. This is their zone press.
About 2 seconds to get it over, and they do. And that also works defensively because now you're working with 25 seconds instead of 35 on the defensive end.
Without a doubt. And it's also why you have to practice to get ready for these guys 7-on-5 because it feels like they have 7 defenders.
Shot clock's under 10. Waiting for Dwayne Evans to get something going. McCall steps into a 3 and drains it. A big basket there.
Remember, this team is undefeated on the road. And they've had a couple of tremendous comebacks. They've been skating on the edge for the last month.
Well, we were talking off air. That stopped an 11-3 run, which is an 8-point difference. And 8-0 runs have been a big factor for VCU this year.
Yeah, they sure have.
Coming up on 7 minutes to go in the first half. Burgess the drive. And the ball's going to go out of bounds to VCU. VCU, the crowd has been on its feet for most of the first half, and they lead by 7. And here in Richmond, 8 offensive rebounds for VCU, kind of counteracting their 13 missed shots.
And watch what we talk about. We talk about defensive blockouts. Jet gets the shooter. He's one-on-one. We're one-on-one with McCall, the guard. We must double-team Treveon Graham. Now roll it, guys. When the shot goes up, Glaze has got to stay on the body of Graham. Graham now has a look to the rim because Glaze didn't finish off the job, and that's too easy. And if you're a coach at home, this is something that could cost you a game or a championship.
And right now, the difference is 7 points, and VCU is 9-0 on second chance. Here's a turnover and a run out for Jet. All alone with a left hand.
I'll tell you, Jimmy Cruz has got a... Oh, that's too easy.
Look at Weber all the way to the 10.
They've really spread St. Louis out today. That's something you don't see them give up.
You know, in the first meeting 2 weeks ago, maybe only a third of the game if you added it all up. VCU had the pace going their way. They have pretty much dictated things here so far tonight.
And again, the Billikens fortunate to only be down 7.
What's remarkable is that this St. Louis team gave up 71 points in a loss to Duquesne. They've given up 30. We still got 6 minutes to go in the first half. One of the best defensive teams in the land. 4 to shoot. Evans has been quiet, and here come the Rams. Weber again looking to probe. Double team. Good job by Briante Weber to keep possession. And now the reaching foul against St. Louis.
Well, this is the formula so far for those 30 points you talked about. Points off turnovers, offensive rebounds. We haven't really talked about much about anybody's half-court offense today. And that in itself is an indication of VCU dictating this first half.
And foul on Mike Crawford was his second, and with just under 6 minutes to go in the half already, VCU is in the bonus. And so Melvin Johnson will shoot 1-1. And the front end goes down. A reminder, our coverage of college hoops continues tonight, 9 Eastern, over on ESPN. Number 5, Kansas takes on Oklahoma State. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV, part of Bracket Builder Week. The game's also live on Watch ESPN. And the Cowboys have played a much better brand of ball since Marcus Smart has returned.
Well, they have. Tonight's a big test. You and I will both be at the Big 12 tournament on TV and radio. Huge game for the Cowboys tonight against the Jayhawks. They're going to keep that trap on.
Nice job by Jet on the jump pass, but a quick blitz out on the double. Here's Jet pulling up over Weber. Reddick's going to jump it over Evans. Missed it short that time. And a foul called underneath the basket.
You know, Mark, both teams played Thursday night. VCU, you mentioned, played up at Fordham. And the loss that St. Louis suffered at home against Duquesne. St. Louis in the first half, not getting to loose balls, really not on top of their game, like the team we've seen for much of the season.
Well, it's a big test for the Billikens, who rose to number 10 in the rankings for the first time since the mid-60s. and they hadn't lost since early December, lost to Wichita State, went to 31-0 to finish out their regular season. And the call off the bump, no call, could have taken the shot, does here, but Allie Cox got the perimeter block.
That's a 7-1 win spread we talked about.
5 minutes to go in the half. One of the more intimidating arenas for visiting teams to face here in Richmond. 49 consecutive sellouts. Weber tried the reverse. Manning and Jett both got a hand on it. Goes out of bounds to the Rams with 11 to shoot.
Funny you mentioned that. This is the highest ranked team to ever play in this building against VCU.
Yeah, back in 1994, down the road, just a piece at the Richmond Coliseum, Louisville was ranked number 11. But ironically, the two other ranked teams who played at VCU both got wins. So that's a testament to just how tough it is in this facility. And that, a lot of that goes to Shaka Smart and the program he has built here.
Well, Jeff Capel, they've had some great coaches here. Sonny Smith is an outstanding coach. Mac McCarthy did a really good job. Look at that.
Almost had it clean inside to Reddick.
Then in recent years, Jeff Capel, Anthony Grant, both left here. And you know, you think Shaka Smart may have gone to school a little bit on both of those decisions. Because Jeff Capel now at Duke after being let go at Oklahoma. And quite frankly, Anthony Grant struggling a little bit at Alabama.
Here's Reddick with a left hand putting it in. Well, not only has Shaka Smart stayed at VCU and continued the tradition, they've won NCAA tournament games each of the last 2 years following up the Final Four. Oh, by the way, he's got a top 15 recruiting class coming to Richmond next year.
Well, you don't pick up your dribble right over midcourt.
And a block at the rim by Javonte Reddick. Gently shot changer that time out of bounds. And the call goes to VCU.
Watch Javonte Reddick just erasing that shot at the rim. That leads to transition opportunities.
The only knock on Javonte Reddick was more consistency in the block, but just an excellent rebounder, shot blocker. This year also scoring, coming off a big scoring game the other night. Lewis goes all the way deep. And a loose ball foul is going to go against VCU.
Well, Javonte Reddick, Mark, he's top 15 in the league in scoring, top 10 in rebounding, shot blocks, and steals. Take a look. The eraser.
Jamie, thanks a lot. Take a look at the this is the current number one seeds in bracketology. Syracuse losing, Virginia winning. Things are in flux here in the final 2 weeks.
Without a question, we have a lot of basketball left. Kansas lurking on that two line, according to Joey Brackets. So much is going to be determined, really, even during the week of the championships.
Championship week not far away, and St. Louis, which won its first 12 A-10 games, coming off a home loss. And right now, this is the biggest deficit they've faced so far today. And look at that, second chance points, 11-0. Offensive rebounds, 9-0. Havoc turning it over 7 times so far in the opening half.
Pretty good half-court defense so far.
There's Jett. No continuation there as he was fouled on his way into the lane. Olfea with the call.
One of the weaknesses, one of the minor weaknesses of Havoc is, and this has been true of VCU in the past, if you handle the pressure and the traps, they're not as good in the half court. And why that is they practice so much on their full court defenses. But St. Louis hasn't had a chance to exploit those driving opportunities yet. A couple times by Jett.
Jordan Jett with 8 points on 4 of 5 shooting. Much of that at the rim. McBroom nearly had it taken away by Lewis. VCU turns over teams at a rate of number one in the nation. And if you're watching from tip, you see why.
They switch the pick and roll.
Jet had a tight window to squeeze through and off St. Louis out of bounds.
In the first meeting, they showed hard on the pick and rolls, but they stayed with their man. Today, they're switching pick and rolls, and what makes Treveon Graham such an effective player as a power forward is he can guard perimeter guys, because essentially he is.
Nine turnovers now for the Billikens. That matches the nine field goals they have here in the first half, and hence the reason down 11. Rob Brandenburg with the drive, finding Mo Ali Cox, who got a pass Manning. Boy, if they can get some offense out of Mo Ali Cox, that's another bonus from the big man. Eight straight points, one of your patented 8-0 VCU runs.
Oh, yeah, it's been done a couple times this season.
Here's Jet blocked by Ali Cox. And in Bill Russell style, kept it in bounds. Graham. And that man again, Ali Cox, in the right spot, gets fouled underneath.
I mentioned earlier, he's only 6'6". But look at the activity in the lane. It doesn't matter if you're 6'6", if you do have the 7'1 wingspan and you know how to put it to use. There's a lot of guys walking down Broad Street in Richmond with long wingspans. You don't get it done unless you know how to use it on the court.
It's only a redshirt freshman, but the champ behind us, Mo says no.
That's right.
Mo says no. Ali Cox gets the first one to go down. He's only a 55% free thrower, and ESPN's family of networks will bring you two great matchups in women's basketball tomorrow. One Eastern on ESPN, Duke against North Carolina. Then Monday at 7 Eastern, ESPN2. Undefeated UConn will take on Louisville. They lead them by a game in the American Women's College Basketball, part of Bracket Builder Week. Both games also live on Watch ESPN. Knocking down both free throws, a folk hero already.
During the season, Mark, VCU averages seven more shots than their opponents. Tonight, they have 16 more shots than St. Louis does.
And a backcourt foul, Javonte Redick, a little too much body on Dwayne Evans. That'll be the first on Redick, team foul number five. There's that, we're in a 10-0 run right now, but we mentioned a couple times the 8-0 run. That's pretty significant.
Well, it's significant because they have a scoring margin of plus 8 a game, right? So if you get one 8-0 run in the game, theoretically, that might be the difference in a 40-minute game, and the 8-0 run might only be a 3-minute run. So if you play them even for 37 minutes, you still lose by 8.
And a whistle underneath. St. Louis in the midst of a drought here of almost 5 minutes of basketball without a point. And it's going to be a non-shooting foul, the sixth foul, so it'll be a baseline inbound for St. Louis. Mike McCall Jr. circling into the lane. And he shoveled the low, didn't look like he was ready for that pass, and he gets blocked by Ali Cox, the leading shot blocker for VCU.
Well, Lowe has not really helped his team today.
There's a nice pass from the big man, though. And Evans couldn't get the English, and now holding his left hip as he gets up slowly. The leading scorer has struggled. Javonte Redick can't get the fall. Evans looks very uncomfortable, 0 for 5 in the game. And right now struggling on defense against the bigger Ali Cox. Austin McBroom, that ends the drought for St. Louis. A triple for the sophomore from North Hollywood, California. Coming up on a minute to go in the first half, VCU has already planted 38 points against St. Louis.
Evans still holding that left hip as he guards Redick.
See if Redick goes after him, instead tried to go over the top. Low with the takeaway. Here's Barnett falling to his left.
McCall was going to go to the rim, and then he thought better of it because of the shot blocking presence.
40 seconds to go. A quick three taken and missed by Lewis. See if Barnett drives to the basket. Does. And the timeout called by Shaka Smart with 31.1. 10-point game off the Jake Barnett basket. VCU in control early.
like he just came out of left field, as you see Dwight Evans still holding that left hip.
Yeah, Dwayne Evans had a big game last time these two teams met.
Did I just say
you went Dewey Evans on him?
Did I just say Dewey Evans thinking the former right fielder?
Well, it is spring training.
That's right. It is spring training.
Well, Dwayne Evans of St. Louis struggling in consecutive games. Shot clock is off. And so VCU can work on his 10-point lead. Four to shoot. Graham in and out. And that's the half of it in Richmond, and a very impressive first half by VCU as freight trains Graham with 9 points to lead the way. Jordair Jett has 8 for St. Louis, which is down at 10. And now let's send it to the studio for the Land Rover halftime report.
Thank you, gentlemen. This is the Land Rover halftime report. Syracuse and...
Well, they say havoc lives here, and it did in the first 20 minutes. VCU by 10 over the number 10 ranked team in the nation, St. Louis. Welcome back to Richmond with Brent Fraschilla. I'm Mark Kestisher. We talked about havoc, and havoc indeed, Shaka Smart's team set up in the opening half.
6 blocks, 8 steals. That tells you a lot, and also the fact that they, VCU got 14 more shot attempts at the rim, and here's why. Havoc, not only in the full court, but the half court. Graham with the run out. Another steal. Coming at you, Melvin Johnson to the rim. And then I thought they did a really good job. There's Jared Guest on the offensive glass. Missed block out off the free throw. Graham puts it in. Relentless effort in the first half by VCU. The good news from St. Louis, they're only down 10 points.
As you see, that's their largest halftime deficit of the season. How about that? Field goals for the Billikens, 11 of 22. So they shot 50%, but the 11 offensive rebounds, 13-0 in second chance points slotted to VCU. And that is all equaling this biggest deficit of the year for St. Louis. The Billikens will have the ball first. Biggest halftime deficit of the year, I should say, for St. Louis. And the good news is Dwayne Evans inbounding right in front of us. So he was dogged by a sore hip toward the end of the first half, and we'll see how loose he is holding the ball here to open the second half.
Wow, Deonte Weber is guarding Rob Lowe.
Huge mismatch. And tipped away out of bounds. It'll stay with the Billikens.
And there's no reason Lowe should bring this ball down here. Look, they're taking advantage of it. Watch him dribble it. That allows Weber to get a piece of it and do what he does best.
And Melvin Johnson on the back end as well, poking it away. Evans, 0 for 5 in the opening half for St. Louis. 8 seconds to shoot on this first possession. Evans blocked by Reddick. 3 to shoot and a change in possession.
And he gingerly runs up the floor.
Swiping at Weber. Graham had a thought about a 3, but was standing what would be the NBA line. So defensively, VCU plays 35 impressive seconds. Reddick, short. All right, if you're Jim Cruz, what have you told your team? What are you looking at here early in the second half?
I think you got to look at the positive. We're fine. We could be down 20. We got to use some of that veteran experience and just climb back into this game possession by possession.
5 seniors all on the floor, including Barnett, who misses his first attempt in the second half. Out of bounds to VCU. St. Louis team that had run the table in the Atlantic 10 to start the year, an uncharacteristic loss at home against Duquesne, and now a tough end to the season on a nice spin move by Graham. Reddick blocked at the rim.
Well, they spaced the floor for Graham. They love to do that at the end of the break to take advantage of Evans, the fact that he doesn't look like he's 100%.
Again, Lowe and Weber. Huge mismatch on the block.
Well, Rose got to be careful. He's loitering in the 3-second lane.
Would you like to see him more aggressive to get the ball in that mismatch? It was kind of just lingering there as they turn it over.
He's not posting up aggressively.
Melvin Johnson missing. on the baseline is going to go against Treveon Graham. It'll be his first of the game.
I think what you want to do right now if you're St. Louis is they run continuity pick and roll, side to side, get the ball moving, and then Jordaire Jett, who's a more explosive scorer in the second half of games, needs to start imposing his will on the game.
Jett losing the handle, but has 1 second to get it across and just did. Now they're going to start this offense with 20 on the shot clock from half court.
There's their pick and roll continuity.
Jett's going to line up a three. Graham goes over Evans right to Rob Brandenburg. 2.5 minutes into the second half, neither team has scored. Out of bounds, officials look at each other, and it goes to St. Louis. Jordaire Jett, see what he could do here in the second half, because in A-10 play, that's been his MO so far.
But I think he's got to attack the basket. He's got to put pressure on the VCU defense, draw some defenders for the kickouts. He's a relentless driver with great strength and quickness.
And you see Evans headed to the bench, still clearly affected by what appeared to be a hip injury late in the first half. Well, this is a test for St. Louis as well, because they've mostly been ahead this season. And now Glaze to the basket, got too close. The follow by Jett will get into the line. But it's a team that generally, with the offense they have, which is not as good as you would like to see with St. Louis, fighting from behind has been. If you're just joining us and didn't see Dwayne Evans, their leading scorer and rebounder, going up for the basket and landed awkwardly there and immediately grabbed that hip. And he's going to check back into the game as he heads to the bench. He's going to try to tough this one out.
Well, he had a big game in that first meeting, 21 points. He's very, very good around the rim and using the rim to protect his shot. Tonight, he's taking it right at the shot blockers, and they're sending it back on him.
And Jett splitting the free throws. As VCU scoreless in the first 3 minutes of the second half. Johnson lost it, but it went off the head of Barnett and caromed out of bounds. Barnett never saw it. Break for VCU.
Take a look right here. Here's the drive. Off the foot. Boom. Side of the head.
Well, by the time he saw it, it was too late.
Yes.
All right, Evans trying to defend now. We'll keep an eye on number 21 in blue. Jaquan Lewis in, out, and back in for the first points of the second half.
This is a kid that had 50 in a high school game as a senior last year at Dixon County in Tennessee, right outside of Nashville.
The second three-pointer for VCU in the game.
Great ball pressure, challenging with high hands.
Here's Evans inside, and that'll be his first field goal of the game, coming 23 minutes and change into this game. A relentless attack of VCU and the floater from Johnson. Out of bounds, Jett last to touch.
Johnson almost hit Vermelvin. That's what they call his floater in this place. He named it himself. That's the Melvin.
Well, Melvin Johnson, statistically, when he's in the lineup with the first team, they're scoring a little more than a point per possession. And so he's been in the game to start the last two. As Jim Cruz switches up his big men, 1-6-11, John Manning is in. Rob Lowe heads to the Billiken bench.
You see Melvin Johnson, played at St. Benedict's in Newark.
You see you beating the five count there. It's a big game for the Rams, who right now are sitting third in the Atlantic 10, thanks to a UMass's loss at Dayton today. Not only do you want to make the top four in the Atlantic 10 to get the bye to the quarterfinals, but if you could be a two or a three, you stay away potentially from the number one seed, St. Louis, who hasn't clinched yet.
I'm not sure after today there may be a number one seed. And not that St. Louis hasn't had a phenomenal year. There's just so much balance in this league.
Dribbling it out of bounds. Turnover, St. Louis. What a game it has been for the Rams so far. Another sellout crowd. 49 in a row. And it is Jaquan Lewis hitting a three. Things going the Rams' way so far. Jim Crews working in the St. Louis huddle. His team down by 12 on the road at VCU. We were talking a few moments ago, Fran, about the Atlantic 10 standing. St. Louis had gone 12-0. They might only be a game up over St. Joe's. We're talking Player of the Year candidates. Who do you like in the A-10?
Well, so many good ones, really. These three guys come to mind. Langston Galloway has had a tremendous impact on St. Joe's season. But then you look at St. Joe's with Ronald Roberts and Dennis Savage has been solid. But what a year. Dayton gets to be the sixth team today with 20 wins. Dayton's still in the picture. Nobody knows the A-10 better than Joey Brackett, so I'm sure we'll be kept well abreast of the conference's chances the next 2 weeks.
Jordair Jett, one of your Player of the Year candidates with 9 points here so far. Burgess, a nice move, couldn't finish. Out of bounds, officials look at each other and they'll say it goes to St. Louis. And for St. Louis, as much as Jordair Jett's been so clutch, has hit late baskets. But Dwayne Evans talking to most of the players. He's kind of the heart and soul of the St. Louis team, and he's playing at less than 100% for much of this game. They need him to get going.
Well, both of those guys play with great toughness, good looking side.
Blowing it, knocked away by Weber, but it comes right out to McBroom. Just can't get that shot to fall. They're going to get another opportunity. Weber again goes right to low and a whistle. What's the call? Fair. Tony Chris talk it over. It's going to be on VCU.
You know, I mentioned this earlier about Lowe. This game is too fast for him. This particular game is too fast for the big fella. He's had opportunities to score at the rim. He puts it on the floor or gets it stripped. He's got to play. Now, he is who he is because he can play both outside and inside. But he's got to play with more force at the rim in a game like this.
They're asking him to do maybe a little more. He's been kind of that perimeter big man.
Yep.
Good passer. But when you've got a couple of guards guarding you, sometimes you got to step up just a little bit.
He's had a great career. I got a chance to see him when he played under 19s for New Zealand back in 2009.
Jared Guest picked up that foul. Now they got Allie Cox working on Lowe's, trying to get the ball in the post. I don't think Jett's confident in him.
I think you're exactly right.
Jett will take the shot. And a great save by Treveon Graham, and he gets fouled on the sideline.
That play epitomizes the first 25 minutes. You got a number of blue shirts right there, and look who comes up with it. Three blue shirts, and Graham winds up getting fouled.
Jake Barnett picks up the foul. Shaka Smart, right place, right time. The only guy really could slow him down. His motion on that sideline. VCU set the tone early, and they continue their double-digit lead here. As the top team in the Atlantic 10, without a rally, staring at a second straight loss. Brandenburg kept his pivot foot down, but missed the jumper.
Good defensive possession by Lowe. Kept Brandenburg from getting into the paint.
Jett accelerating into the lane. Brandenburg got a hand on it, but Jett got it back for the easy two.
This is the Jordair Jett Jim Crews needs the last 13 minutes of this game. He's got to take over.
Weber will pull it out, looks over to Shaka Smart for the call. Allie Cox against Evans, stripped by Lowe, got a hand on it. Allie Cox got it back, tied possession. The arrow stays with VCU.
See, that's the second possession of Lowe. Rob Lowe has been more active. Watch him do a great job of keeping Brandenburg from getting to the rim. And then he comes up with that tie-up on the jump ball. And he posted strong that possession where Jett didn't throw it in. So I think he understands He's got to pick it up.
Graham in and out of the three. Now St. Louis a chance to get it into single numbers. Finding Evans cutting. Pump knowing Allie Cox was there and he still got a hand on it. The other way. In and out three. Tipped out and McCall comes up with it.
Numbers.
McCall going end to end. But can't finish. Now VCU might have some numbers. It's three on three actually as Graham brings it up. Neither team can find the basket now. Grante Weber says, let's slow this down, reset it up in a 10-point game with 12:45 left.
I like the renewed energy of the Billikens. Now they've got to convert some of those shots.
Weber, the jet kind of sagging off. Graham will take it in the lane and the foul on Evans, who is standing straight up and moving a bit to his right, gets tagged with the foul.
These two guys, Evans and Graham, I call them player forwards. They're not really four men, they're not really three men. In a sense, they're undersized fours. And when you play as an undersized four, you think of guys like Jimmy Butler at Marquette and Jay Crowder at Marquette. You have to have toughness to compete against bigger guys around the rim. Treveon Graham does that.
Treveon Graham, their leading scorer, number two rebounder, has 10 points, 8 rebounds so far in this game. It's a big game, not only at home for VCU, and not only against the number one team, St. Louis, but, you know, they came into the league last year in the Atlantic 10. They lost to St. Louis in the championship game, and you got the feeling around here in Richmond, it's time to beat St. Louis.
Well, there's no question. I wouldn't say it's a burgeoning rivalry, but these are two teams that have developed winning cultures in recent years. And of course, the culture at St. Louis started by the late Rick Majerus.
Another near steal. They are all over the passing lanes, giving the Billikens fits. Knocked out of bounds, it'll stay with St. Louis. Crowd wanted to travel before that ball got knocked out of bounds.
And I thought McCall knocked this ball out of bounds. Let's take a look. Official was right on the play, and Graham around it as well. Hard game to officiate. These guys have done a good job. I mean, this is a hard game to officiate.
Yeah.
Because both teams play with such activity.
And the baseline J goes down for Austin McBroom.
Well, he's an energizer off the bench. It's crazy, Mark. St. Louis has played below par. They're only down 9.
They have held VCU to 6 points so far in the second half. Guess missing. And Lowe goes up for the rebound. So 6 points in about 8.5 minutes. That's St. Louis basketball. Getting it done on the defensive end.
See, well, now Lowe's calling for it, and I like that.
Being guarded by Melvin Johnson. Very patient Billiken team. Guest. Shot clock hits 10. Big man gives it to McBroom, who hits again from the other side. Here come the Billikens. And Shaka Smart sensing that, calling for time. The offense has gone silent for VCU. They haven't had so much of the havoc and getting those easy transition points. As Rob Lowe, we kind of called him out a few minutes ago, but he has stepped up on the defensive end. Great passer for a big man, and McBroom has made this a 7-point game.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Audi. Truth in engineering.
Reminder, NBA Sunday Showcase tomorrow. How about the Bulls up to 3rd in the East? Joakim Noah and the Bulls take on the Knicks 1 Eastern. It starts with NBA Countdown presented by Speedstick Gear at 12:30 Eastern Time.
Nobody gets more out of his talent than Tom Thibodeau, and nobody epitomizes Bulls basketball right now more than Joe Noah.
Yeah, he's doing a great job. And right here, talk about the difference first half to second half for VCU.
Well, what's most important about that drought is when you don't score in havoc, you don't get a chance to set up that full court pressure. St. Louis has taken advantage of that in the half court.
So out of bounds will take us to break, and well, Shaka Smart's trying to draw something up to get a basket made. left. VCU's lead is down to 7, and only 2 turnovers for the Billikens. Not only havoc has not worked, but they haven't been able to get those transition points going.
Oh, exactly, and it's allowed St. Louis to climb back in slowly.
A 14-6 Billikens run in the last 11 minutes. A foul underneath against St. Louis. Mike McCall.
You know what amazing stat? I just looked at the box score. VCU has 10 steals, no surprise there, and 10 blocks. And that's not a big surprise when you think of Redick and Allie Cox, certainly.
Allie Cox with 5 block shots in this ball game. Check out our game summary. There's that 14-6 run, and go back to the first half. VCU with only 6 points. Amazing. After you saw them score the first 38.
Well, you must keep them out of transition. They're not certainly as good in the half court, as Shaka Smart told us today, as they are when they allow the defense to set up their offense.
Well, the Johnson with a big turnaround stick there.
And that's why he's back in the game, because he is instant offense.
The sophomore from the Bronx, and now a chance to set up the havoc.
Watch Cox. He's lurking, lurking. Here he comes. And he's going to, there he is.
Even though they don't turn them over right there, continued disruption, cut the shot clock in half.
Exactly. Wow.
And Lowe is trying to pass it out to McBroom. They miscommunicated. That's only the 3rd turnover of the second half, but a big one there.
Watch Mo Allie Cox now. He's lurking, working in midcourt. Here he comes. And then a man-to-man full-court press becomes a zone trap at midcourt.
Double fist of the Havoc defense. You know, we call it Havoc, as you mentioned, show generically, but there are different facets of it. And the floater goes in. Treveon Graham up to 12 points. And just like that, VCU's lead is to 11.
That's the beauty of Treveon Graham, is his ability to beat you off the dribble as a theoretical 4-man. Here comes the trap. Watch Graham.
McBroom spinning out of it, and a foul.
Here you see Shaka Smart, Mark. At his first press conference, he said to everybody who was there, we're going to try to wreak havoc on our opponents. And who knew that throwaway line would stick as what represents their culture here? And there you see the term. And as I said earlier, it's not just the defense. Everything they do is about creating this.
Jordair Jett beating VCU down the other end. That is the moniker that's defining this program right now. Graham straight on 3.
Now that's your trail man, who's really a small forward playing the 4 spot.
Well, he's a pick and pop 4 who could take down Eric Maynard's school scoring record one of these days. Maynard's jersey hanging above us here at the Verizon Wireless Arena.
When they drive it to the basket, watch Graham at the top of the key. He sucks the blue jerseys in, Weber does, on the penetration, and Graham's sitting out there all alone. And then he becomes the mad dog on the press.
I like that call, the mad dog, the big guy at the head.
That's what they call him. What?
Simon McBroom, speedy. Nice drop to Lowe, pump fakes and puts it in. That's the first points for Rob Lowe. Graham, little heat check. Johnson right there. Well, Weber was thinking about leaning into a big one,
no,
and then realized
not.
He might head out to the bench.
He's not. He's made 26 in his career. That's not his game. He thought about it, but not for long. You know, Weber reminds me a little bit of Rondo.
Okay.
You know, he affects,
long arms.
Yeah, and he affects the game without making jump shots on both ends.
And a carry call against VCU. Well, Brown did not like that call, turning it over to St. Louis.
Yeah, he's not, Weber's not the passer that Rondo is, but just the way he can affect you on the defensive end, his dribble drives. He was being recruited by Mike Rhodes, the associate head coach, when Mike Rhodes was the head coach at Randolph-Macon. He saw him play as an underclassman and thought, you know what, this Weber kid might be a good D3 player. Mike Rhodes came to VCU to be an assistant on Smart staff, went to see another player, saw Weber who had grown and said, you know what, this kid could play and have it.
There's Jordan. Jetto has a knack for the basket, especially in the second half.
Now Jet's got to just throw caution to the wind and create offense now on his own.
And we talked about Weber, Jet the same way, and that happens in the quote-unquote mid-majors. That kind of term has gone by the wayside, but under-recruited, guys maybe late bloomers, and also eventually four-year starters.
That's going to be two shots because it was a tip, and a tip is considered a try for goal.
Foul on John Manning. And so we'll get those free throws after the timeout. VCU's lead, just 8. It's a big bracket builder for VCU at home against number 10 St. Louis. We're going to find out now, Fran, why we're going to get 2 free throws for VCU off that foul.
It's the rule. It's under Rule 5, but a tip is a try for goal. And any part of the hand that touches the ball on that try is considered possession. Now, Jimmy Cruz is arguing that. Paul Fay is saying, nope, that's the rule. And that the tap starts when a player's hand or fingers touch the ball. Pretty clear in the rule book.
John Manning picks up his first foul for St. Louis. And VCU will head to the line unbeaten here at the Siegel Center, 13-0 at home. They've actually won their last 18 home games dating back to last season. And this is their first home game in the last 17 days, and 7,741 came out to pack this building for the 49th straight time, and Javonte Redick headed to the line.
This young guy, Redick, played with some good players in high school. Remember Quincy Miller, who played at Baylor and left early?
Now in the NBA with Denver?
Yep. But you know what? Quincy, I thought, left early. All this kid has done is had a terrific 4-year career and gotten better each year.
Redick knocking down both. A 10-point game. Something's got to give tonight. Told you about VCU hasn't lost at home. Well, St. Louis, along with Wichita State, the only teams in the nation yet to lose a road game. And a true road game at that, which it is tonight for St. Louis. Second half field goals. VCU only 5 for 18. But ever since that timeout that was taken by Shaka Smart, able to make a field goal, reset their full court pressure, and now defending for the first 30 seconds here. Jet falls to the ground, but he fell to the ground, pushed with 6 on the shot clock, and Javonte Redick gets called for the push.
Well, Jet was trying to get into the lane, and let's see if he just slips. Any kind of contact, you know what? From that angle, I don't see contact.
He's got a hand on the right hip, but that wasn't him.
Oh,
that
man.
Was Weber.
No, I think he just fell down.
Yeah.
You know, it looked like it, you know what? Give Redick credit because he's really good at stepping out and guarding those smaller players.
Second foul on Redick. It's only the 15th foul of the half against VCU. 10-point game. We have 6:50 left to go. Jet losing his balance and turns it over. Redick lob for the rim, and the finish for Brandenburg. Another St. Louis turnover turning into points, and a whistle down low against the Rams.
Watch
Brandenburg.
Watch this, Mark. Watch how hard the trap is now. This is called a short roll right here. Throw it to the big guy in the foul line as opposed to rolling to the rim. But Jet couldn't get the ball out of the trap.
Brandenburg, who finished there on that turnover, gets called for a second personal. 16 fouls against VCU. Next one will put St. Louis in the bonus. Barnett stopped. They got a reset. VCU's half-court defense has been very impressive today.
They've blown up the continuity pick-and-roll offense today.
There's Evans with a big hit. Seems a little more fluid now. Been dealing with that hip injury earlier.
St. Louis, you need stops, but you got to get some easier baskets than they've had to work for.
Under 6 minutes to go. Redick just tossed one up. And now a chance for the Billikens to get a little closer. Trailed by 15 late in the first half. Trailed by 10 at the half.
See, VCU switching everything today. They didn't do that 2 weeks ago. But they have five guys on the floor that can all play perimeter guys.
Inside pass for Evans. Never touched it. Out of bounds. And another St. Louis turnover with 5:32 to go. 14 turnovers for the Billikens today. Now, if you've seen this new wrinkle, you're going up against a defense that is switching on you. How long does that take for the team to make the adjustment
well,
to
they,
it?
So far, it's taken 35
yeah,
minutes.
That's a good point.
You know, and what you got to do when you play against teams that switch, you got to slip the screens early. You got to relocate, not necessarily to the rim, but into open spots. St. Louis hasn't adjusted. We saw VCU work on this today. Completely different wrinkle than what the Billikens saw in St. Louis.
There's Weber accelerating to the lane.
Rondo.
That did have a Rondo look to it. Briante Weber from Chesapeake, Virginia. And the reigning defensive player of the year in the A-10 and probably going to be two-time defensive player of the year coming up with a basket there.
One of my best point guards at Manhattan, Keaton Hyman. He was from Chesapeake, Virginia. He's watching this game right now saying, yep, I've seen this before.
10 points, 5 boards, 3 steals for Briante Weber. Here's Jett trying to take over. And a block call. Count the basket. Jordaire Jett a chance at a 3-point play.
I love that. They spread VCU out. And this is what Jett does so well. Gets to the rim, defender slides, easy call. Watch him slide.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
A little hop back. You had the feeling it's almost Jordaire Jett time for St. Louis, under 5 minutes to go.
Yeah, there's no question.
Had such a huge second half in the first meeting. Already has more second half points here today. And before he takes the free throw, St. Louis going to call a timeout. So St. Louis a chance to get within single digits in a moment. But a reminder, our coverage of college basketball coming up at 9 Eastern ESPN. We'll have number 5 Kansas against Oklahoma State. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV, part of Bracket Builder Week. Games also live on Watch ESPN. So impressed with Kansas. You know, we talk about the Kentucky freshmen and their freshman class, but the freshmen for the Jayhawks have played very well, maybe none better than Joel Embiid.
Well, he's certainly a revelation.
Yeah.
You see the 10 consecutive titles. And by the way, Andrew Wiggins has had a really good season, and we pick him apart from time to time with regard to his NBA potential.
But only because the bar was set so high.
No question. Guess what? He turned 19 a week ago. Not bad for an 18-year-old for most of the season.
You know, we just saw that graphic, as you pointed out, with the 10 straight. I mean, that sometimes goes overlooked at what Bill Self has done, especially when the Morris twins graduated. Looked like they had a down year, not enough talent. Just rack up another Big 12 title, and they're headed toward Kansas City with a chance maybe at an overall number one seed. Might even move there this week if they can get the win tonight.
Well, I think they have a real chance to be on the number one seed line.
Right.
The way Florida's playing, the way Arizona's playing.
And your thoughts on Wichita State? That's been a heavy topic at 31-0. Heading into their tournament.
I'd be shocked if they're not a number one seed as well, based on what they've accomplished. By the way, they weren't bad last year.
No. They went all the way to the Final Four.
What I laugh about Wichita State with regard to the skeptics is, were you not paying attention last year when they had Louisville down 11 in the second half of the national semifinal?
Yes.
I mean, give me a break.
Yep, Cardinals had to come back in that game on their way to the national championship. Jordaire Jett picked up his third foul moments ago. 4:20 to go in a 9-point game. VCU going to run a little time here. Oh, Graham switched the feet.
Almost
might have got away with it.
Yep.
10 on the shot clock. Johnson, a long three, comes up short, and a big rebound for St. Louis.
This is a huge possession.
In night and day, the defense of St. Louis in this second half after giving up 38 first half points.
See, if they score here and they get to the timeout, Jimmy Cruz can strategize a little more.
Jet, a little too strong that time. 3.5 minutes to go.
Wow.
Well, crossover from Johnson. We'll go to the free throw line after the timeout. If St. Louis does not come back in this game, their Atlantic 10 lead will be down to one. And Briante Weber, it's your boy Rondo.
Look at Mike.
Takes it all the way to the rim.
But he showed up today.
All right, Jamie, thanks a lot. And here in Richmond, VCU has held St. Louis to 48 points at the 3:29 to go mark.
Well, and we talked about this. This is what, you know, this is what they do. Create intense pressure. They make you play at a style and speed you're not used to. And even a quality team like St. Louis has struggled with this defense today.
Well, VCU taking advantage of all the turnovers, though they struggled the first 9 minutes of the second half. Missed 11 of their first 13 shots. Billikens cut to 7. Since then, VCU 5 of 9, but Melvin Johnson missing the first of 2 free throws. Bags the second. There's the numbers. 14 turnovers forced. That is over St. Louis's season average. Billikens turned it over 16 times the other night. There you see the steals. All number one in the country.
How about if I told you that VCU would shoot 38% and 3 for 15 from behind the arc? It'd still be up 10.
I don't think I would have believed you. It sounds like a 30 for 30 entry.
You get a little music too?
McBroom missing on the three and a whistle underneath. Paul Fayo with the call.
Personal foul is charged to number 32.
And it's on Melvin Johnson. His second personal. .302 to go, and Rob Lowe will go to the free throw line.
Watch Melvin Johnson. Remember, we talked about the switching today, right? So Johnson and Lowe tangled up inside, and Johnson with the choker holds right there.
Pushing him on the waist pretty hard. Lowe knocks down the front end. And Rob Lowe had a little shaky start to this game. 6 rebounds, 5 in this half, has really stepped it up for St. Louis.
And I'm thinking here, if he cuts to 8, I used to do a drill every day with my team in the second half of the year, down 8, 3 to go. And the key here is you don't have to make it a comeback game yet. You just need a couple stops and a couple scores.
There's Weber in the middle of the lane. And a whistle inside, a hold against St. Louis. That should be their 7th. So we'll have a 1-1 coming up for Briante Weber. Barnett picking up his 3rd. Team foul number 7. Weber, a 78% free throw shooter.
Now this would be a real bonus for the Billikens if Weber would miss this free throw, obviously. Because they didn't have to guard the whole 35-second clock. They only guarded about 10 seconds.
Weber gets the first one to go.
But Weber has other ideas.
Briante Weber, 6'2 junior.
Well, he had a flying elbow when he got to VCU. Really poor shooter. But when you see his free throw stroke, pretty good. He's just not accurate behind the arc.
Seems a lot of it is confidence. Really had to step up this year being the point guard, not just the great defensive stopper. And we have a whistle before the inbound.
Now the same thing's going to be true for the Billikens. They can put some points on the board. And I don't think any time came off the clock because it wasn't inbounded. 2:51.
Well,
By the way, McBroom's not a bad free throw shooter either.
Yeah, he's only missed six times this year. 89% free thrower. 2 for 2 tonight. This is really playing into Jim Crews right now. We don't need your under 3 minute drill when the clock is stopped this month.
No, but you know what? It's part of it. You really do have to know how to play in these situations. I used to do it every single day. Some days I would take my point guard off the first team, put him on a second team, because you're going to have guys foul out. Create all kinds of late game situations that way.
Shaka Smart wanted an explanation on that last foul called against Jordan Burgess. And now sends Mo Alley Cox into the ball game for Melvin Johnson. So more of a defense for offense switch here.
I'm wondering, the clock never started, so substitutions. I'm trying to figure out when Barnett came out of the game, because if he came out of the game at 2:51,
you can't
go back in until the clock starts.
And there you go. There. Now, does Jim Crews have that option to send Barnett back on the floor?
Well, he must have been in, you know, quite frankly, he must have been in the game already, because the clock, at least to my mind, it never started, because it was 2:51 on the previous foul. Ball never came in bounds, but now McBroom gets a chance to cut it back to 8.
Austin McBroom hitting the first to transfer from Central Michigan. Had a great freshman year there.
Yes, he did.
All Mac. It seems like we have more confusion as Graham and Melvin Johnson are looking to check in for Burgess and Allie Cox.
I think Jim Crews is asking what I'm thinking to myself. You know, can you sub if the clock hasn't stopped? I should say start it again, because that is the rule.
Well, it was on 2:51 for a long time. McBroom hitting both free throws. 8-point game in Richmond. Redick looking to take on Lowe.
They tried to isolate Lowe with Redick. It didn't work.
Here's McBroom speeding down court. Weber was right there to defend him. Forced a tough shot out of bounds. Officials look at each other. It stays with the Billikens.
There's McBroom trying to draw some contact. Good job by Weber, you know. He just poked at the ball.
Here's Lowe, catch and shoot. Tipped up. McBroom comes away with it and lost it. Couldn't get the handle on his way up to the basket.
That is indicative of the kind of night it's been for the Billikens. Yep, McBroom just fumbled it. And it's been one of those nights. And they're still in the ball game.
15th turnover by St. Louis. VCU is comparably taking care of the ball well. Has not shot it as well, but in the first half, took advantage of a spate of offensive rebounds, 11 of them. Got out to a 15-point lead and trying to hang on. 5 on the shot clock. Graham dances, shoots the 3. And Lowe comes up with another second half rebound.
Yeah, Rob Lowe's been more engaged in the last 15 minutes.
Ball kicked out by Weber. Coming up next, after we are finished here in Richmond, we will have UC Santa Barbara and UC Davis.
Hey, you want to see a double-double machine? Alan Williams for the Gauchos. Excellent.
There's a steal by VCU. Weber does it again, and Johnson finishing on the other end.
That's what he does.
And another turnover. The foul on Lowe.
This is havoc personified. One guy who sets it all up. The face of havoc, Briante Weber, leads the country in steals. 3 straight years he's led the country in steal rate. He gets a steal, Mark, once out of every 13 or 14 possessions.
Let's check in quickly back in the studio, Jamie Sire.
Yeah, thanks, guys. At number 17, Kentucky, and against ranked opponents. A reminder, UC Santa Barbara and UC Davis coming up right after this game. It's going to start over on ESPN News. Corey Hawkins getting ready to go if you're looking for that game. Mark and Fran, back to you.
All right, Jamie. Yeah, it's kind of the blessing and the curse of having such great recruiting down in Lexington.
Well, it's absolutely why those rankings mean very, very little. When you look around the country at guys like Treveon Graham, Briante Weber here today, Jordaire Jett, Marcus Foster from Kansas State, a freshman, all those guys Lon Kruger has. It's not those highly ranked guys. Doug McDermott, look, what about the career he's had?
Yeah.
Right? Those ratings mean nothing when they're on a piece of paper.
Briante Weber has had a fantastic day today. The reigning A-10 Defensive Player of the Year, who, Fran, eventually is going to be the Atlantic 10's all-time record holder for steals in a season.
Well, no question. Catching up to UMass's Edgar Padilla, but the effect he's had on his game and the way he's had an effect on this season for the Rams leads to the easy basket for Melvin Johnson.
Four steals tonight. That gives him 105 on the season, number one in the nation, three away from tying Padilla's all-time single season record in the conference. 12 points, five boards, four steals for Weber. UC Santa Barbara, UC Davis, if you're looking for the start of that game, head over to ESPN News. We'll be back here on ESPN2 as soon as we wrap up from Richmond. Minute 15 to go. Graham, great look to the wide open Redick. That could be the exclamation point here in Richmond.
It's hard to press VCU because this is what they do every day. They were very comfortable out of those traps.
Jett knocks down Weber, no call. Loose ball on the baseline. They're going to say it was last touch by Johnson, but I thought the ball had creeped on the line before Johnson slid over there. Of course, Tony Crisp had a much better look than I had here at midcourt.
Hey, remember, this last week of the season, St. Louis will host a Dayton team that got its 20th win, and they'll finish at UMass.
Not an easy place to play.
No, and a screwy part of the Atlantic 10 schedule this year is they only play UMass once. They haven't played the Minutemen 14 months.
Have to face Chaz Williams and UMass coming up to finish off their season. St. Louis, after winning its first 12 conference games, as McCall got held by Treveon Graham on his way to the basket. Unless they have a huge comeback here with 53 seconds to go, that lead in the A-10 is going to be down to one game over St. Joe's, who also hasn't gotten a lot of talk. They've all of a sudden quietly won six straight, playing way better here toward the end of the season than they did earlier in the year.
And they're the numbers. They speak for themselves. This is a league that lost some pretty good programs last year, including Butler. And the league seems as strong as it's ever been.
VCU began the day tied with UMass for third. VCU loses most of the tiebreakers, so with UMass losing today, VCU will be in that three spot heading into the last week.
And by the way, I am a huge Chaz Williams fan. I've enjoyed watching him over his 4 years. There's no way he's 5'9". But you talk about one of the best point guards in the country, and you can put him right up there with anybody.
He is a nightmare to defend. Barnett got a hand on it, and we'll get called for the foul.
Personal foul is
52 seconds to go. And for Shaka Smart's VCU team, you know, their record 21-7. We haven't put the win in their column yet, and only 9-4 in the conference. But realistically, they had a very tough schedule that they played toward the tail end of February. A lot of good teams on the road,
and they still have to go to Richmond, you know, a rival,
big rival here.
You're exactly right. UMass, St. Louis, St. Joe's, I mean, really the top of the league pretty much. That's what I don't like about the unbalanced schedule, but some of these conferences like the A-10 have gotten so big, there's no choice but to play the unbalanced schedule.
Graham hits the first and the second. VCU looking to go to 10-4 in conference. Forty-five seconds to go. McCall chasing it down in the corner. Evans with his foot on the line. Low with an offensive board and a putback. And a timeout called by Cruz with 28 seconds to go.
Right now it's about regrouping and getting ready for Wednesday when the Flyers come to town. Been a long season. You know, we had a conversation with Jimmy Cruz today. Remember, he said basketball season's too long.
Yeah,
remember that?
Yep, earlier today. Yep.
And they've had such a great year. They'll be 25-4 after today. And really, I guess you could say the Duquesne loss was a bad loss, but losing at VCU, there you see the remainder of the schedule. Losing to Wisconsin and Wichita State, certainly nothing to be ashamed about.
That's the remaining schedule for St. Louis. Dayton game coming up at UMass, and here's what VCU has looking. We talked about the game at Richmond, just a few miles across town here. They'll wrap up at home senior night against St. Bonaventure, and then the Atlantic 10 tournament in Brooklyn. And it should be very entertaining with this conference. Very competitive from top to bottom. And what we're seeing here, things getting a little tighter. Looked like St. Louis was etching its way toward that number one. And they still have two more chances to clinch at least the conference title in the number one seed. But the first two chances have gone by the boards.
Well, winning a second regular season A-10 title would certainly be a huge achievement. And it's something the senior class has built towards. You know, they suffered the only losing season in Rick Majerus's history as a coach when they were freshmen. But it's been an upward trajectory the last 3 years. Already the winningest senior class in Billiken history.
There you go, five senior starters, only three teams doing that in Division I. They've got three 1,000-point scorers, and you mentioned the winningest class in school history. And I saw a quote last week for the late Rick Majerus when he got to St. Louis and predicted how his team would be a top 10 team within 3 years of the point he mentioned it.
Yep.
And sure enough, they got to top 10. And he really planted the seeds, and Jim Cruz has done just a fabulous job taking over. And coming up right after us, it'll be a UC Santa Barbara and UC Davis. That game right now on ESPN News. 22 seconds away. Briante Weber working on a big offensive game to go with his defensive prowess. Lowe will try a three. Reddick the rebound, and unless they foul, VCU can run it out. And they will, and this full house of 7,741 watching VCU go to 14-0 at home and hand St. Louis its second straight loss after a 12-0 start. Its first loss on the road this year, unbeaten Wichita State, the last team, obviously, unbeaten on the road. VCU 67, St. Louis 56, the top of the A-10, getting a little tighter heading into the last week of the regular season. Coming up next, UC Santa Barbara taking on UC Davis. Let's send it out to Davis, California.